It didn't matter. 1941, the last year of peace. The isolationists grew more hysterical as it became obvious that it would be only a matter of time before America entered the war. But what did it matter if the world was about to self-destruct? In that last wonderful summer, Ted Williams of the Boston Red Sox hit 406, and Joe DiMaggio of the New York Yankees achieved his immortal streak.
Hello, Joe. What do you know?
We need a hit, so here I go.
Ball one.
Hey!
Ball two.
Hey!
Strike one.
Ooh!
Strike two.
Kill that umpire.
Yeah!
A case of Wheaties.
He's just a man and not a freak, Jolting Joe DiMaggio.
Joe, Joe DiMaggio, we want you and I side.
He tied the mark at 44, July the 1st, you know. Since then he's hit a good 12 more, Jolting Joe DiMaggio.
Joe, Joe DiMaggio, we want you and I side.
From coast to coast, that's all you'll hear of Joe, the one-man show. He's glorified the horsehide sphere, Jolting Joe DiMaggio.
Joe, Joe DiMaggio, we want you on our side.
He'll live in baseball's Hall of Fame, he got there blow by blow. Our kids will tell their kids his name, Jolting Joe DiMaggio.
We dream of Joey with the lights from back. Joe, Joe DiMaggio,
we want you on our side. And now they speak in whispers low of how they stopped our Joe. One night in Cleveland, oh, 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 goodbye Street DiMaggio.
...1941 also saw Hitler make his greatest mistake. He had served bravely in the trenches of World War I and had grown to respect the character of his British enemies. He still cherished the hopes of a negotiated peace with Britain, leaving him free to carve up the rest of Europe. Tired of their stubborn resistance, he turned his attention to the Eastern Front, hoping that the British would collapse of their own accord. On June 22, 1941, he invaded Russia. The Russians counterattacked and retreated, drawing the enemy ever deeper into alien territory. Casualties were appalling. On December 5th, 2 days before the attack on Pearl Harbor, the minarets and spires of Moscow were visible to the invaders. That was the closest they would ever see them in life. As the Russians had planned, General Winter took command. The Germans were forced to retreat, fighting every step of the way, and although they launched a further offensive in the spring of 1942, it was one of the greatest turning points of the war.
Well, now Stalin wasn't stalling when he told the Beast of Berlin that he'd never rest contented till they had driven him from the land. So he called the Yanks and English and proceeded to extinguish the Führer and his vermin. This is how it all began.
Now the devil, he was reading in the good book one day how the Lord created Adam to walk the righteous way. And it made the devil jealous. He turned green up to his horns, and he swore by things unholy that he'd make one of his own. So he packed two suitcases full of grief and misery, And he caught the midnight special going down in Germany. Then he mixed his lies and hatred with fire and brimstone. Then the devil sat upon it. That's how Adolf was born. Now Adolf got the notion that he was the master race, and he swore he'd bring new order and put mankind in its place. So he set his scheme in motion and was winning everywhere, until he up and got the notion for to kick that Russian bear. Well, now Stalin wasn't stalling when he told the beast of burden that he'd never rest contented till they had driven him from the land. So he called the Yanks and English and proceeded to extinguish the Führer and his vermin. This is how it all began. Yep, he kicked that noble Russian. But it wasn't very long before Adolf got suspicious that he had done something wrong. 'Cause that bear grabbed the Führer and gave him an awful fight. 17 months he scrapped the Führer, tooth and claw, day and night. Then that bear smacked the Führer with the mighty armored paw, and Adolf broke all records running backwards to Kharkov. Then Goebbels sent a message to the people everywhere that if they couldn't help the Führer, God, don't help that Russian bear. Well, now Stalin wasn't stalling when he told the beast of Berlin that he'd never rest contented till they had driven him from the land. So he called the Yanks and English and proceeded to extinguish the Führer and his vermin. This is how it all began. Then this bear calls on his buddy, the noble fighting Yank, and they set the Führer running with their ships and planes and tanks. Now the Führer's having nightmares, 'cause the Führer knows darn well that the devil's done wrote to welcome on his residence in hell. Now Stalin wasn't stalling when he told the beast of Berlin that they'd never rest contented till they had driven him from the land. So he called the Yanks and English and proceeded to extinguish the Führer and his vermin. That is how it all began.
In the spring of 1940, America passed the Selective Service Act. A fistfight had broken out in the House during the debate, proving that the country was ready should war come. By early 1942, millions of American men were being drafted into the four branches of the armed forces.
This is the Army, Mr. Jones.
This is the Army.
No private rooms or telephones.
This is the Army.
I had my breakfast in bed before,
but you won't have it there anymore. This is the Army, Mr. Green.
This is the Army.
We like a barracks nice and clean.
This is the Army.
I had a housemaid to clean my floor,
but she won't help you out anymore. Do what the buglers command. They're in the Army and not in a band.
This is the Army, Mr. Brown.
This is the Army.
You and your baby went to town.
This is the Army.
She had you worried, but this is war, and she won't worry you anymore.
Bell-bottom trousers, coat of navy blue. She loves her sailor, and he loves her too. Oh, bell-bottom trousers, coat of navy blue. She loves her sailor, and he loves her too. Oh. Once there was a little girl who lived next to me.
That's me.
And she loved her sailor boy, he was only three.
That's me.
Now he's on a battleship in his sailor suit.
Zoot.
Just a great big sailor man, but he's just as cute.
Boot.
Bell-bottom trousers, coat of navy blue. She
loves her sailor, and he loves her too. Oh, when her sailor boy's away
on the ocean blue,
soldier boys all flirt with her,
but to me she's true.
Though they smile and tip their caps,
and they all go boing,
she just smiles and shakes her head,
then she sings a song.
Bell-bottom trousers, coat of navy blue,
navy blue,
I love my sailor and he loves me too.
Keep 'em flying, keep 'em in the sky, keep 'em flying, hitting hard and high. On every lip the fervent cry, keep 'em flying, Uncle Sam. Keep 'em flying, every headline screams, keep 'em flying, army fighting teams. On 30,000 different beams, keep 'em flying, Uncle Sam. From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, we fight our country's battles on the land as on the sea. Admiration of a nation, we're the finest ever seen, and we glory title of United States Marine.
In the 1920s and 1930s, the American military was the last hope for people unable to find any type of employment. Now men were pouring in from every walk of life. Sometimes adjusting was difficult.
My brother Bill is in the Army now. We heard from him today. Waistline's getting back to normal now. Here's what he had to say. Oh, I miss your apple pie. Oh, I miss your stew. Oh, they're treating me all right, but they can't cook like you.
Only men with specialized skills needed for the war effort were exempt. Big band leaders like Benny Goodman, the Dorsey Brothers, and Duke Ellington lost some of their key sidemen. Artie Shaw avoided the problems by enlisting with his entire band.
He was a famous trumpet man from out Chicago way. He had a boogie style that no one else could play. He was the top man at his craft. But then his number came up when he was gone with the draft. He's in the Army now, a blowing reveille. He's the boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B. They made him blow a bugle for his Uncle Sam. It really brought him down because he couldn't jam. The captain seemed to understand, because the next day the captain went out and drafted a band. And now the company jumps when he plays reveille. He's the boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B. A toot, a toot, a tootily, a toot, he blows it eight to the bar. in boogie rhythm. He can't blow a note unless the bass and guitar is playing with him. He makes the company jump when he plays reveille. He's the boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B. He puts the boys to sleep with boogie every night and wakes them up the same way in the early bright. They clap their hands and stamp their feet because they know how he plays when someone gives him a beat. He really breaks it up when he plays reveille. He's the boogie-woogie bugle boy of Company B.
And what of the wives and sweethearts left behind? Things were very different from World War I.
Women are now doing more and more of the necessary operations for building aircraft. Thousands of women are at work in arsenals on all kinds of ammunition, bullets, shells, and bombs.
Lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down. Pistol packing, mama, lay that pistol down.
But on one level, women's reactions were the same as they had ever been.
All our friends keep knocking at the door. They've asked me out 100 times or more. But all I say is leave me in the gloom. And here I stay within my lonely room. Cause I don't wanna walk without you, baby. Walk without my arm about you, baby. The day you left me behind, I take a stroll and get you right off my mind. But now I find that I don't want to walk without the sun. Or you'll break my heart for me. Oh, I don't want to walk without you. No, sirree.
So were the men's.
Don't sit under the apple tree with anyone else but me. Anyone else but me. Anyone else but me. No, don't sit under the apple tree with anyone else but me. Till I come marching home. Don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me. Anyone else but me. Anyone else but me. No, don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me. Till I come marching home. I just got word from a guy who heard from the guy next door to me. The girl he met just loves to pet, and it fits you to a T. Don't sit under the apple tree with anyone else but me. Till I come marching home.
Stay away from that tree.
Blackout restrictions were imposed with varying success.
When the lights go on again, all over the world, and the boys are home again, all over the world. And rain or snow is all that may fall from the skies above. A kiss won't mean goodbye, but hello to love. When the lights go on again, all over the world, and the ships will sail again, all over the world, then we'll have time for things like wedding rings, and free hearts will sing. When the lights go on again, all over the world.
And Americans experienced the horrors of rationing.
Now we're going to have a new system of rationing, I hear.
Yep, that's right. I'm going to start point rationing pretty soon, they tell me.
Why on earth do they have to do that? We have a perfectly simple system for sugar and coffee. I can't make heads or tails of it. I wish someone would explain to me just why we're going from one thing to another.
How many of us have overheard just that sort of conversation during the past few days since the announcement by Secretary of Agriculture Wickard that canned, dried, and frozen fruits and vegetables were to be rationed within a short time? Well, we have someone here who's prepared to answer some of questions that have arisen and explain what these new developments are all about. Mr. Paul M. O'Leary, Deputy Administrator in charge of rationing in the Office of Price Administration.
Good evening.
Mr. O'Leary, I think you're the right man to answer the questions that seem to be bothering Mrs. Hendricks and her grocer. They're here right now.
I'll be glad to try. Tell me, Mrs. Hendricks, why did you particularly want canned tomatoes rather than some fresh vegetable?
Well, Mr. O'Leary, it's so hard to plan my husband's meals. He very often works overtime and doesn't get home to dinner at all. I like to have a canned vegetable on hand. Fresh vegetables do spoil, and I don't know just when I will have time to use them.
That partly answers one of your questions about the why of this canned food rationing, doesn't it, Mrs. Hendricks? The Army has to plan meals for over 1 million American soldiers scattered over all the earth, and they have to be fed canned foods because only canned foods will be useful for months. You can imagine what fresh tomatoes would look like when they got to North Africa.
Hey, that's right, Mrs. Hendricks. I know what spoilage means with fresh fruits and vegetables. Are we feeding soldiers a great amount of canned goods overseas, Mr. O'Leary?
Yes, indeed. We certainly are. For the Army and Navy and our fighting allies as well. They are fighting on our side, and they can do a better job with some good, substantial American food under their belt.
Yeah, Mr. O'Leary, that's going to take an awful lot of canned stuff.
Yes, but we've got a lot. We have been at peak production as far as food is concerned.
Then I still don't see why we need rationing.
Even with that superproduction of ours, we are still going to have to cut down our consumption of canned food.
Mr. O'Leary, you mean rationing?
That's right. We've got to divide among our civilian population what we have left after feeding our fighting men. And that means it will be a little less for some of us, but a fair share for all of us.
Well, I'm all in favor of seeing that those boys get first chance of whatever there is.
Yeah, Mrs. Hendricks has a son in the Army herself, Mr. O'Leary.
Oh, there may be a shortage of sugar, of aluminum pots and such, but there won't be a shortage on love when we love each other so much. What if they have to ration out rubber we were getting from the Dutch? Oh, there won't be a shortage on love when we love each other so much. Let the taxes rise, we'll economize and cut our budget in two. We can trade the car in for a horse or a bicycle built for two. We can still have a portion of moonlight, another helping of stars and such. So there won't be a shortage on love when we love each other so much.